So, good afternoon, one and all. Thank you for your brief introduction. And as we discussed during last lecture, we have discussed about the overview of pharma industry, medical device industry, and the nutraceutical industry. And there is a huge potential, huge opportunity for the young buddies and those who are willing to start their own business, for the startups and other people who are, willing to make their career in all these three industry, pharma, medical device, and nutraceutical. And I hope you understood that lecture in a better way. I have shared the link about the recordings as well with Dr. Narendra. So if you want to hear me again, you can just click that link and move ahead. So after the first lecture, which was very important, and you understand the importance of all this industry, how we are at the global level and how we will be during next 3 to 5 years. Now we are going to deep dive, so in that after that lecture, I have covered, if you recollect, the regulatory affairs, what is regulatory affairs, what are the roles and responsibilities of regulatory affairs professional, and how this world is divided into regulatory market, So regulatory affairs is nothing but what? It's a collecting, analyzing, and communicating risk and benefit of pharmaceutical product to different agencies all over the world. When I tell the regulatory affairs is collecting and analyzing, that means a person has to collect, the regulatory affairs professional has to collect all the information from different stakeholder. Their stakeholder could be what? The internal department like QC, QA, R&D, production, purchase, packaging, and all other department from where all the data is coming from. And that regulatory person has to review that data, compile the dossier into CTD, ECTD, or any other format as per country-specific requirement, and then submit to health authority. Coming to health authority, there are regulated markets, semi-regulated market, right? And regulated market means those are highly stringent, follow strict regulations, stringent standards, and so on. So ICH is out of it, ICH is an international council on harmonization for the drug substance and drug product, and who has defined such a beautiful guidelines under the quality, safety, efficacy, and multidisciplinary. Correct? So under quality, if you see, there are so many guidelines like Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, Q5, up to Q13 to Q14. Correct? And if you try to remember all those guidances, that would be a really, really great achievement, I would say. Those who are already into MPharm, or those who are out of MPharm, those must have seen all those quality, safety, efficacy, and even under multidisciplinary, the M4 and M8 guidelines are important when we talk about the CTD and ECTD. CTD means common technical document, right? In which we have to compile the dossier in 5 modules. So in this way, the regulated and the semi-regulated market is divided, and any applicant, like though it is Sandoz, Novartis, Cipla, Sun Pharma, all these companies, they are an applicant. They are registering their drug substance, drug product to different countries, and they have to follow the country-specific rules and regulations. And when we talk about regulated and semi-regulated market, the rules and the the stringent standards are a little bit of different. But when we talk about highly regulated market, it is a mandatory requirement to submit your dossier in the electronic CTD format, that is ECTD. Okay, so each applicant has to go through the drug substance and the drug product file, and you know the difference, right? Drug substance and the drug product, and how the regulatory roadmap for this drug substance and drug product we are going to discuss in today's session. Okay, So coming to this, as I said, this is a disclaimer. All the content has gathered from the freely available sources, and the sources acknowledge. So who controls the entry to the global market? The governmental agency that regulates drugs and drug product approvals in the public interest. So role is to provide legal framework for clinical trials so as to protect the safety and rights of the subject participating in a trial and to ensure that trials are adequately designed to meet scientifically sound objective. Correct? So as I mentioned earlier also, any health authority's main objective is to protect public health. And in order to protect public health, we have to meet those three parameters, that is quality, safety, and efficacy. Okay, so out of which the quality is derived during your GMP manufacturing, correct? GLP is a good laboratory practices. So together, if you see GMP, GLP, GCP, GDP, it is together called as GXP. Okay, so GXP, if you try to follow GXP, if you are GXP compliant, then you can meet all the regulatory standards, rules and regulations, and you can able to demonstrate that you are following all the standards and you are producing all the product in the GMP environment, and that meets this quality, safety and efficacy. Okay, so again, the clinical trials, you must have studied, there are phase, non-clinical phase and phase 1, 2, 3, and there is phase 4 as well. So all these clinical trials also should be conducted under the GLP environment and following GCP, E6 guidelines. So as I mentioned, the ICH is divided into quality, safety, efficacy. So there you have to follow safety and efficacy parameters, and the very beautifully guidelines are available, written by Europe, US and Japan, that is the ICH tripartite body, and you it is freely available on ICH.org.com. So you have to refer those guidelines when you are conducting clinical trials. Okay, then again, the second role of any governmental agency is what? To ensure diagnostic or therapeutic potential of investigational molecule in humans and animals. Correct? So once you complete your non-clinical studies in animals, then you have to enter into human studies, right? And that is why you are going forward with the IND application. IND is an investigational new drug application. You'll see what are different INDs, NDAs, and so on. And all this happens because we have to ensure the safety and efficacy of the drug substance and the drug product, and to ensure easy and the cost-effective availability of the therapy to the patient, correct? And to protect rights and give benefits to the innovator or manufacturer of the drug and drug product. So as I said, there are regulated and semi-regulated market, and country-wise, there are different health authorities. In India, CDSCO, okay, the Central Drug Standard Control Organization, and we have the central body, that is DCGI, Drug General Controller of India, headquartered at Delhi. Then USA is a Food and FDA, that is Food and Drug Administration. So FDA is a common term used for any local body. In India also, we call it as local FDA. So FDA means Food and Drug Administration. But when we talk about US FDA, United States of America, it is US FDA, Indian FDA, like that, you know. So FDA is a common term being used in various health authority. Otherwise, couple of countries they use, like in Europe, it is used as EMA, that is European Agency for Medicinal product. Australia, it is Therapeutic Goods Administration, TGA. Japan, it is MHLW. UK, MHRA, that is United Kingdom's Medicine and Healthcare Product Regulatory Agencies. Germany, it is BfArM. Brazil, it is ANVISA. Southeast Asian nation, that is ASEAN. In this, there are 10 countries, right? So Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, Brunei, all those, Laos, Cambodia, Vietnam, all those 10 countries falls under this Southeast Asian nation. And there is this International Conference of Drug Regulatory Authorities and WHO authorities. So there are several other authorities. And once you become a part of WHO, you can export your product to 130 nations. Okay. Now we'll see there are different applications. When we talk about US FDA, we have to submit IND, NDA, ANDA, BLA. Then there are veterinary products that is called NADA, that is New Animal Drug Application. And ANADA means abbreviated New Animal Drug Application. So like our NDA and ANDA, in veterinary it is called NADA and ANADA. Okay, so that is the difference. Otherwise application, if you see, more or less it is similar. When we talk about biological, it is BLA. So we are going to learn different application, how it looks like, what are the content goals under each application. So under US FDA laws, we have to follow Food and Drug Cosmetic Act, and even in India we follow Food and Drug Cosmetic Act 1940, correct, and the 1945 rules. So under US FDA there are CDER, that is Code of Federal CFR, sorry, CFR, CDER, CBER. So there are different guidelines available if you see. And along with this Food and Drug Cosmetic Act, you have to follow CFR 21 parts also. Then PDFU, that is Prescription User Fee Act, GDUFA, PDUFA, so these are all the common terms used in US FDA. If it is an animal drug, ADUFA, So ADUFA, GDUFA, PDUFA, So like that, P stands for prescription drug, G for generic drug, A for animal drug. So easy to remember, GDUFA, PDUFA, and ADUFA. Then the Public Health Service Act, that is PHS Act, and there is a very popular act, that is Hatch-Waxman Act and Amendment. Because of these two, Henry Hatch-Waxman Act, there is a provision to enter into market when the patent is expired. And this law came into picture in 1984, and these two gentlemen came together and they have made all the product which are in which is called as Me Too product or the generic product, and which is easily available, cost at an economical rate to the patient. And really we are thankful to this Hatch-Waxman Act, and because of which many people could afford the therapy, the cost-effective therapy. Otherwise all branded player is to be there, and the very costly drugs are still very costly drugs are available in the market. Why it is costly? Because those are branded, those are branded, and for to get one drug product, NDA, it takes like 10 to 12 years, because they have to go for non-clinical and clinical phases, and that's how the time, the cost is very huge. But now, since the Hatch-Waxman Act and Amendment is available since 1984, anyone can enter into the generic drugs. So we'll see, the one by one the application. And before that, as I said, any NDA, any NDA has to go to so several years, zero, you can see. So this is the preclinical phase, and this is clinical phase, and this is the post-marketing phase. So just see how many years does it take. And that's how the new drug development process is very costly, and the branded drugs are very costly because of this number of years, number of patient, number of money invested into this. This is a popular chart you will find everywhere, you know, phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four, and all. Then once you submit NDA, then only one can list their product into Orange Book. And once your product is listed in Orange Book and you get the NDA number, then only anyone else can go for the NDA, you know. So we will talk first about how the drug substance are filed. You know, the drug substance, when you have to file as per US FDA, it is called US DMF. You know, it is submitted to FDA CDER. So under this section 21 CFR 314. Okay. So once you understand about the DMF, the drug substance part, then it is easy for you to understand about the drug product form. First of all, you have to understand why drug master file are required, you know. So to maintain the confidentiality of proprietary information, example, manufacturing procedure for the holder, and to permit review of information by reviewer at FDA to support application submitted by one or more applicant. Okay. So the facts are what, like, the submission of DMF is not required by law or FDA regulation. A DMF is submitted solely at the discretion of the holder, and DMF is a reference document in case of third party manufacturer. What I mean to say here, anyone who are into bulk drug business or API manufacturing business, if they go for registering their, you know, applicant part, that is DMF, the open part, to the US FDA, they get the DMF number. But it is not a mandatory requirement. But once you file and you get the DMF, it is freely available. The DMF number is published on US FDA site. So that any person who is the formulation, applicant who's want to use the API from any party, you know, the third party manufacturer, he will look into who has having the DMF number. That means US FDA has accepted your file and DMF number is received. So that person will approach the drug substance manufacturer and get that DMF, you know, the open part, and then he will go ahead and manufacture his finished product. So here the important point you have to consider, that DMFs are not approved or reviewed, but when the your API, your DMF is used by somebody else to make the final product, the finished product, that time his ANDA or his generic application will be open and your DMF will also be reviewed, because each finished product comprises of API plus excipient, and that's how his finished product file is open, and along with that your API part, the DMF part, is also reviewed. But during that you have to give the letter of access, to FDA on behalf of the manufacturers of finished formulation. So what is the content of DMF? DMF is very important. It comprises of, you know, all CMC information. CMC is nothing but chemistry, manufacturing, and control. So here all the manufacturing, processing, packaging, storage, you know, the stability data, everything is covered under the CMC, cover CMC of the component of the drug product and the drug or drug substance of the drug product information under this drug master file. So there are four types of DMF, mainly five types of DMF, but the one and five, if you see, it's not no longer applicable, but only type 2, type 3, and type 4 are applicable. So what are type 2 DMF? It is mainly for the drug substance intermediate, and material used in their preparation of the drug product. Type 3 is for packaging material, and type 4 is for excipient, colorant, flavor, essence, and material used in their preparation. So these three, type 2, 3, and 4 are active DMF. So mainly we are using, since we are working in pharma industry, we have to file type 2 DMF. Okay. So once it is, you send the application, you get the acknowledgement letter from USFDA and you get the DMF number. Each DMF holder has to submit the annual report, submit letter of authorization for each item, reference for each customer. Suppose if you have one DMF, but your customer could be 100. So each customer should get that LOA, the letter of authorization. Because when that customer will use, your DMF to manufacture his finished product, this LOA becomes very important, based on which the FDA has full authority to access your DMF because he has used in his finished product. Clear? So if it is clear, I will move forward. Now, IND, you must have heard, this is a popular term used in everywhere. So IND is nothing but it is investigational new drug application. Correct? So when we have to we have to study animal pharmacology and toxicological studies, we have to go for IND. So once you apply for IND, you have to, during IND, you have to get some the proof of concept study, the formulation is workable or not. So that CMC data also goes along with the IND, along with your clinical protocol and investigator information. So here, this application is to, seek the legal approval to test diagnostic or therapeutic potential of investigational molecule in human. So once you submit your IND application, you have to wait for 30 days, okay? So when you wait after 30 days or so, you don't get any response, that means your IND is accepted, So that means whatever data you have provided, it is safe and your IND is accepted by health authority and you can move forward with the next clinical studies, okay? So there are different types of IND, investigator IND, treatment IND, emergency use IND. Okay, so investigator IND means, so investigation in patient population must involve a physician. Then there is research IND, the investigational aims is to study unapproved drug, to study approved product for new indication and study effects on new patient population. So under this investigators IND, there is research IND, and which is, aim is what? To study unapproved drug and approved product for new indication and to study effect on new patient population. So all these three terms are very important when you are under research, okay, research IND. Then the treatment IND for experimental drug showing promise in clinical testing for serious or immediately life-threatening condition submitted to authority while the final clinical work is conducted for review. So it's pretty simple. The clinical testing for serious or immediately life-threatening condition, it goes with the treatment IND. Like corona is the, case, because it was life-threatening disease, and so that you can, directly apply through treatment IND and move forward. Then emergency. So emergency also, here also we can quote that, corona, the COVID-19 vaccines and all. So in emergency situation, emergency use IND, FDA can allow use of such experimental drug without submission of an IND in accordance with 21 CFR. What are the key features can be used for patients who do not meet the criteria of an existing study protocol and can be used in the absence of approved study protocol also? I hope it is clear about IND. Say yes or no.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Then we move forward with the NDA. What is NDA? NDA is a new drug application, and which is proposed to get an approval for sale and marketing of new pharmaceutical from FDA. So here you have to keep in mind the very important parameters about safety, labeling, process and control, you know, CMC and all. Because by the time you reach to NDA stage, you have crossed four phases, like preclinical and under clinical phase 1, 2, 3, right? I will just show you once again. This chart is very important. This chart. So you can see the preclinical study under which you go for synthesis purification. Okay, and it is a short-term study in the animal. In the animal studies, you collect the pharmacological and toxicological data and move forward with the clinical phases in human. This is animal phase, this is human phase. Under human phase, if you see phase 1, 2, 3, after phase 3 only you can apply for NDA. And that's how all this data of preclinical and phase 1, 2, 3 goes under NDA. So NDA is very huge, and which talks about the, you know, safety, quality, efficacy, all data goes into this NDA. So whether the drug is safe and effective for its proposed use, you have to check under safety. Whether the benefits of the drug outweighs the risk. So always you have to see the benefit should be more than the risk to the patient, correct? So unless and until you are able to demonstrate that your product is very safe and many benefits are there for the patient, okay, the subject. So then only any health authority will take into consideration that yes, you have proven, you have sufficient data of phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, and so that, you know, there is should be reason to approve your NDA. Okay, then the label claim, whether the drug's proposed labeling, that is package insert, is appropriate or not, and what it should contain. This is also very important when we talk about NDA, because by the time you have established safety, efficacy, and label is in, you know, proper shape, you package insert with the contraindication and all, you know, the indication, contraindication, the dosage form, stability, everything is well established. Then the process and controls, whether the method used in the manufacturing the drug and the control used to maintain the drug quality and adequate to preserve the drug's identity, strength, quality, and purity. So here we are talking about, you know, the manufacturing process for your drug. The drug development process in that GMP part is also very important. Because when you develop the drug, you should find out the method to analyze also, test. How do you control all the quality parameters like drug's identity, strength, quality, purity, everything should be established. Then some factors from the regulatory perspective is regulation and content of the guidance document. You have to understand the disease and condition being investigated. Then the approved drugs are available. Basis of approval for those drugs, knowledge of the expectations of the reviewing division at the FDA, input into design and timing of non-clinical and clinical studies to support to NDA. Okay, so these are the important factors which are jotted down for you. Then once you submit, there is a pre-NDA meeting with the FDA to discuss about the clinical development issues and to ensure that evidence necessary to support a marketing approval will be developed to discuss these critical issues. What are the critical issues? And whether preliminary evidence of effectiveness was seen in the principal control trials intended to provide evidence of effectiveness, then the structure, content, timing of submission of NDA, structure and content of electronic submission. Because as I said, all health authority, US, Europe, Canada, are looking for electronic submission in eCTD. Okay, so better you understand and learn eCTD concept. All the structure, all the content, you are organized as per the hierarchy of, you know, the eCTD granularity in the electronic submission will be reviewed. Okay, so then the timing of submission of portion of an application for marketing approval if such submission is appropriate. Readiness for and proposed timing for it. So everything, are you ready with all these things? It's just during your pre-NDA meeting with the FDA. Then you have to discuss all these critical issues. Okay? Then again, content of NDA, of course, it contains application form 356H form, which is common for NDA, ANDA, BLE, 5B2. If you can Google 356H form, you will see 3-4 pages form, and on the last page they give the instruction how to fill up that form also. It's very nice and elaborative form which you have to fill for the application. Each applicant has to fill that form, and along with that form, then the other documents goes as per the CTD granularity. Then there is a patent information, patent certification. What under para 1, 2, 3, 4 you are filing, that you have to mention. Then your establishment's description, debarment certification, field copy certification. Then fees, whatever you are paying to US FDA, financial certification. These are all administrative part which you have to give under module 1. Then the labeling, application summary, CMC, non-clinical, clinical, you know. So all these content, if you gather in the CTD and eCTD format, your job becomes very, very easy. So here we have captured just, you know, for your information, what all data goes under that module 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So let us discuss a little bit of about CTD, which is comprising of five modules, right? As I said, this is module 1, which talks about the regional and administrative information. It is usually written as not part of CTD. Why it is written? Because this part contains only the administrative and regional specific information. Okay. So whenever you want to submit your application to US, Europe, Canada, or any of the country, that you have to follow that country specific requirement. Okay. Suppose if I want to submit my CTD, full entire CTD to Japan. So Japan is strict in their own local language, correct? Japanese, Russia, Russian, then France, French, Germany, German. So like that, you have to meet some regional specific requirement, okay? And that's how the module 1 is little different for each country, each region. And that is why it is written as module 1, though it fits into this popular triangle, it is not part of the CTD. CTD means common technical document. So this is not common, regional information is not common, because of the local regional specific requirement. Then module 2 talks about the quality overall summary of these three modules. Okay, quality overall summaries of these three modules, that is module 3, 4, and 5. How it is captured? The quality overall summary of non-clinical overview, clinical overview. Non-clinical summary, clinical summary. And of course, the quality overall summary of CMC you have to attach. In some countries, the expert CV, is attached under the quality overall summary. Pretty clear? Module 1, module 2 is clear. Come to module 3. Module 3, again, it is divided into drug substance and drug product. under drug substance, there is S1 to S7. Under drug product, that is P1 to P8. All CMC information about drug substance and drug product becomes part of this Module 3. Then Module 4 talks about your non-clinical study reports. Module 5 talks about the clinical report. But this is all required for NDA. When you talk about ANDA, these two modules, Module 4 and 5, is replaced with the BABE data. Just to remember, when we talk about ANDA, this Module 4 and 5 is replaced with the BABE data. Clear? So this is what I have just explained to you. These are all, you know, module wise explanation. Now, because of electronic submission, there is no need of, you know, archival copy, in-house copy, and so on. Because it is mandatory to give now electronically, you have to upload through ESG. So earlier we used to submit field copy, archival copy, you know, the review copy, three big binder we used to submit to health authority. And that is now, it is not required, but still some countries are, you know, asking for the paper binder, or at least the CTDs, three copies, you have to maintain one archival copy, field copy, and then you have your submission copy. Then how the review of NDA takes place? Once the review clock is initiated for NDA, FDA has 60 days, you know, and to decide whether not to file or to whether to receive RTR, you know, refuse to receive, whether your NDA is, you know, fit for the review or not, that they will intimate us. And whether the application is complete, notify the applicant of the deficiency and to correct minor deficiency. So it occurs within 45 days after receiving the NDA. And it is reviewed by the team, which may include clinician, pharmacokinetics, pharmacologist, toxic. Because lots of, you know, phase 1, 2, 3 data goes along with NDA. That is why all these expertise, SMEs are required to review your application. It's a huge application, you know. Then the review team attempts to confirm the and validate the sponsor's conclusion that a drug is safe and effective for the proposal. The reviewing division will schedule pre-approval inspection on drug manufacturing site and the clinical trial site is needed. So I hope it is pretty clear about your NDA, ANDA, right? NDA. So how it is reviewed, quick response of the by the applicant will facilitate the review of the application. And each member of the review team will prepare a written evaluation of their section of NDA. So these are some recommendations regarding the NDA. Approval means what? That the drug is ready to be marketed under the provision of Food and Drug Cosmetic Act. Approvable means the applicant may need to resolve additional issues before it can market the drug. Correct? So approval, approvable, and non-approvable means drug cannot be marketed, and review the team will need to justify this recommendation. And of course, you have to maintain also, once you get NDA number, your product is registered. To maintain, you have to go for extensive post-marketing surveillance to prove that, to monitor the safety, you know, the continuous monitoring of safety. Because after NDA, we are going to commercialize your product and it is consumed by lakhs and crores of people. So that safety becomes a major issue. You have to keep watch on drugs adverse event, adverse effect. And that's how this ADE, you know, the adverse drug experience and post-marketing reports, serious unexpected, that is ADRs and all, you have to keep it, you know, watching. So that's PV department is, you know, mandatory when we go for US, Europe, and of course in India also now pharmacovigilance is given importance, and lots of PV people are hired everywhere, pharmacovigilance. Then again, you have to go for periodic adverse drug experience report also, you know. So this is also PSUR and you know PPAR are very important, and in every NDA has to update annually. So every year you have to pay the fees, update whatever changes happen during the year, whatever PPAR, PSUR you have reported, you know, because during the year lots of people must be consuming your drug which is available in the market. And whatever adverse reaction, adverse effect, you have to monitor and report it. Before moving ANDA, I need a 5 minutes break. Okay, welcome back. So now we have discussed about IND, NDA, different phases, how this regulatory affair information goes to US FDA, and how you as an applicant have to provide all the documents, the content of NDA. Then we have seen the DMF also, you know, how to submit DMF, whether DMF is reviewed or approved or not, you know. So now after the discussion of all this, we move forward with the ANDA, which is very popular, and all these applicants are more towards, you know, generic. So there are hardly, you know, any companies who are into new drug application, at least in India. There are major multinational players like Pfizer, GSK, Eli Lilly, Amgen, and so on. But in India, if you see, there are a couple of companies only NDA business. Because what happens when we are into NDA, we have to spend lots of year, and you know the number of years and number of expenses are more, and that is why in India we are into the generic market. Am I right? And that's how we are capturing more the generic market. But still, I could say you know the Opard, like Ranbaxy, Opard, the Lupin, and our Sun Pharma, Piramal, and there are a couple of other companies like Glenmark and all, they are into the NDA and NC business, Dr. Reddy's and all. Otherwise, all other people are into, you know, this generic business. So ANDA, it is again, you have to submit the 356H form. Only in ANDA, we don't have to go for the extensive studies of non-clinical and clinical. So generics drug product is one that, comparable to an innovator drug product in the dosage form, strength, route of administration, quality, performance characteristic, and the intended use. So you have to take care of that generic when you are going to develop. It should be exactly similar to your innovator product. And in this, you have to go for, with the exact dosage form, strength, route of administration, and all other quality parameters, performance characteristic, and the IFU, that is intent for use. Correct? Of course, the module 4 and 5, as I said, is replaced with the bioavailability data. Once you submit your ANDA to the CDER, that is CDER, and it is approved by US FDA, then only you can manufacture and sell that drug product. Correct? So, no need to establish your preclinical and clinical data. that is how this is the difference between NDA and ANDA. As I said, this is replaced with your bioequivalence studies. And once this ANDA is submitted, it is reviewed. And if it is not acceptable, you get the RTR, that is refused to receive letter. And once it is submitted to health authority, the sections are divided into CMC, labeling, and the bioequivalence. And these will be reviewed by different subject matter expertise sitting at US FDA. And everything, if it is okay, then only your inspection will be, called. So you have to go for this request for plant inspection. It will be coming from US FDA, and you have to prepare yourself for the inspection. So during inspection, everything will be, evaluated against your raw data, and that's how you should be in a position to demonstrate that everything was strictly followed. Exhibit batch was manufactured under the GMP environment. All methods which are used are validated as per ICH, like suppose assay method validated as per SHQ2, impurity method as per SHQ3, stability data is generated as per SHQ1. And there are so many other parameters, apart from the stability data and all other packaging data, labeling and everything. So everything is important and everything should be documented. Your process is to be validated. When we take the exhibit batch of 1 lakh unit, so the batch reconciliation data, then the in the batch manufacturing data, you have to give the proposed intended batch record as well. Along with your exhibit field record, you have to go for the intended batch record as well. The intended batch is always batch size will be X is to 10X. Now you are submitting the data for 1 lakh units. So you can go for 10 lakhs unit when you are going to commercialize your product. So that much data is, provided and nicely arranged with the CTD and eCTD, format, and it is submitted. But when the inspection happens, everything will be again checked against whatever you must have submitted during the application. Correct? So you have to prepare thoroughly with respect to quality, safety, and efficacy. And along with your all training records, who are the employees, everything will be seen during the audit. And sometimes what happens, if something goes wrong or some minor issues are there, they might give the, okay result. And but the approval will be withheld because minor issues are there, and we have to give the commitment and we have to reply to agency within a stipulated time, and then only they can give the final approval. Sometimes it is withheld. And in case of suppose if you have minor queries about CMC, labeling, or bioequivalence, the small deficiency letter will be received. And those letter, you have to, of course, reply with the data, backed up data. So documented evidence become very important. And otherwise, you will not get the, approval letter. Then the non-approval letter will be received. So to summarize, once you are prepared with ANDA, it will be reviewed initially within 10 to 45 days, and you will receive either RTR if it is not complete. And if you don't receive RTR, then your file will be, submitted to different reviewer, and different reviewer will say, okay. Then the plant inspection happens. If plant inspection is, successful, then your site and your ANDA will be approved, and it will be published on the US FDA website. So this chart is very important to remember how this generic drug review process takes place. And these are some guidance documents you will find on the website. You have to refer to BAB studies, then the generic filing, from the FDA, then what are the required specification for INDA, NDA, NDA drug master file, then changes to approved NDA, the RTR, So there are then IIG database also there, you know, inactive, then Orange Book, patents. So many things are available. And only thing you have to keep in mind what you have to refer to and how you have to apply that logic when you submit the ANDA to USFDA. Then refuse to receive letter, as I said, when any small error like inactive ingredient level exceeds the level previously used and approved the product via the same route of administration. If the ANDA does not meet the criteria for filing, okay, then there is establishment evaluation request, that is EER, which determines if the drug product manufacturer, the drug substance manufacturer, and the outside testing facilities are operating in compliance with the GMP regulation as outlined by 21 CFR part 210 and 211. Okay, but currently, you know, the all ANDAs are submitted electronically only through the ESG gateway, electronic secured gateway, ESG gateway, for which you have to, you know, apply for the account, the production account. How we operate the internet banking, we get user ID password. Similarly, in USFDA also, you have to open the ESG account and upload your ANDA application via gateway, ESG gateway. Now, how you enter into the generic application, as I said, Hatch-Waxman has made the provision when the patent under Para 1, 2, 3, 4. So Para 1 means drug has not been patented. Para 2 means the patent has already expired. And Para 3 means date on which the patent will expire and that the generic drug will not go on the market until that date passes. Correct? It's pretty simple to understand. And Para 4 is patent is not infringed upon or it is not valid. So Para 4, you have to challenge or first to file patent opportunity, anyone may receive. And there are a couple of examples under Para 4 case studies. If you heard about the Lipitor story about the Ranbaxy and you know, Pfizer, how they sued the case against Ranbaxy when they challenged their patent, you know, under the Para 4 for atorvastatin. So you can find out the case study by Lipitor, Ranbaxy and Pfizer, and you will realize the story, how difficult this Para 4 is. If you have very good regulatory and the patent attorneys with your company, and if you are very confident to challenge the patent against your innovator, then only you go for Para 4. Otherwise, 90% people go for Para 2 and Para 3. Okay, so this become your basis for ANDA submission. Okay, so most of the people go for Para 2 and Para 3. But some people, even I have personally filed Para 4, 4 application when I was working in Sandoz and Glenmark. So it depends on how is your company's regulatory strategy, patent strategy, and how you study the innovator's product, you know, in very detail, in very depth, and then you develop your own product, you know, prove with the respect to safety, efficacy, quality, and so on. So Para 4 ANDA, generic form files Para 4 ANDA, notify the patent holder. So whenever you are filing Para 4, you have to notify to the patent holder, the innovator, and patent holder files an infringement suit against the generic applicant within 45 days of ANDA notification. And FDA approval to market of the drug is automatically postponed for 31 days. So this is the case study which is given for Ranbaxy. If your Para 4 is not acceptable, you know, by the innovator, whatever challenge is given, the patent holder, the innovator, can, you know, sue against you within the 45 days of their NDA notification. And you can get automatic 30 months stay, you know, on your ANDA approval. So 30 months, your case will be fought in the US court law. And if you win the case, that is okay. If you lost the case, what will happen? What has happened to Ranbaxy? They have lost so many trillions of dollars, right? Because the expenses are recovered right from your non-clinical, clinical, all phases, you know, whatever expenses you must have incurred during your development till the ANDA stage, you have to pay in your US court law. that is how it is very stringent to have go for the para four strategy. Then acts governing NDA and NDA. NDA that contains full report of investigations for safety effectiveness, but where at least some of the information required for approval comes from studies not conducted by or for the applicant and for which the applicant has not obtained a right for reference. What are the advantages? It avoids unnecessary duplication of studies already performed on the reference job. Then the mitigation of cost and shortening development time, fast track approval for the wide range of products and especially for those that represent a limited change for existing and approved drug. Clear? So Hatch-Waxman amendment towards fast ANDA approval with ANDA base. Ideal candidates will be, new indication, change in dosage form, strain, formulation, dosing regimen, route of administration, or new combination products, or new active ingredient, or, a product of an existing drug, prodrug of an existing drug. So there are, apart from NDA, there were 505B2 and, B1 application. And this is the requirement because on faster track you can go under this 505B2 case in which you have either new indication for your product or you are changing dosage form from tablet to capsule or any other dosage form or strain. Suppose 5 and 10 mg is already there and 20 mg you are introduced, then you can go for this faster route under 505. Then some people go for like amlodipine bisalate is already there. You introduce amlodipine maleate as a second, next salt or something like that with the new indication. Then also you can go for this route, 505. So this is also possible under Hatch-Waxman amendment. Then come to BLA. Okay, so we have covered IND, NDA, NDA. Now we little bit talk about BLA. BLA is again biological license application and it is purely used for marketing your biological products and which require this license. Okay, so this application is almost similar to NDA. Okay, it is similar to NDA and it covers the contents like chemistry, pharmacology, source of material details, manufacturing processes, labeling, medical effects of the biological product, preclinical to phase 3 clinical studies. So like I mentioned here also, non-clinical and phase 1, 2, 3 studies is required. So it is more or less similar to your NDA. Then BLA goes to CBER, whereas our NDA goes to CDER, correct? So this is for drug, this is for biological. So CBER and CDER, CBER and CDER. So BLA regulatory authorities, that is Center for Biological Evaluation and Research for blood and blood components, device developed to prevent contamination of blood, blood components and cellular products, software used to collect blood and blood, gene therapy, human tissue, cellular products, vaccines, xenotransplantation products and so on. So live animal organ, cell, tissues, and everywhere this BLA is applicable and you can submit to CBER under US FDA. And same, you can go for, the FDA 356H form in which all the parameters you have to look into, fill up that form and attach all the documents as per the CTD, CTD granularity. And you have to submit to CBER, okay? Then intended for use in any species except human veterinary. As I said, veterinary, it is called ANADA, right? So it is same. So NADA is equivalent to NDA and ANADA is equivalent to your ANDA, correct? So only A matters, why it is? Because it is veterinary, the new animal drug application. Okay, ANADA. So here also you have to give same kind of summary, the product development and the generic drug development, new drug development, everywhere like safety, efficacy, cost mitigation, ease of availability. For everyone, like ANDA, NDA, NDA, BLA, NADA, everywhere, you have to talk about safety, quality, efficacy, and how you can provide your more benefit to patient, correct? So, and how you can make easily available the drug. So to summarize, if you want to remember everything in your life and understand the subject in well, the best recipe is what? Read, execute, and record. Okay? So every person has 24 hours in their life, and how to utilize that 24 hours, it depends on you. Okay? So be prepared, and if you fail to prepare, then you are preparing to fail. That is the message I wanted to give with this presentation. And thank you for your kind attention. And we can discuss for 10-15 minutes and we'll close the session. So thank you again for your kind attention. So now we will discuss.